Our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
I bless the body of Charles Lonergan, Jr. with the holy water that recalls his baptism, of which St. Paul writes, all of us who were baptized into Jesus were baptized into his death. By baptism into his death, we were buried together with him, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might have a new life. For if we have been united with him by likeness to his death, so shall we be united with him by likeness to his resurrection. On the day of his baptism, Charles put on Jesus Christ. On the day of Christ's coming, may he be clothed in glory. Is there a worship aid? Charlie's Parish Church to celebrate his wonderful, full, and rich life and of his new life with God. I know we come with heavy hearts. We've lost someone very dear to us. I know I certainly do. But we come also with hearts full of faith, the same faith that Charlie had in such abundance, knowing that he is with God. And we can rejoice in that and call this a celebration, which indeed it is. If there are any here in the church this morning who are not of the Catholic faith, don't feel outnumbered. Feel welcome. Charles would want you to, again, this is his home. He would want you to feel at home. And now in the quiet of our hearts, let us be aware of God, the God who filled Charles with such life and richness and abundance when he was here with us, and who now fills him with the fullness of eternal life. Let us pray. O God, to whom mercy and forgiveness belong, hear our prayers on behalf of your faithful servant Charles, whom you have called out of this world. And because he put his hope and trust in you, command that he be carried safely home to heaven. to enjoy your eternal reward. We pray through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from the book of the prophet Micah. You have been told, O mortal, what is good, and what the Lord requires of you, only to do justice, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Shall want. Fresh and green are the pastures where he gives me repose. Near restful waters he leads me to revive my drooping spirit. Me along the right path. He is true to his name. If I should walk in the valley of darkness, no evil would I fear. You are there with your crook and your staff. With these you give me prepared a banquet for me in the sight of my foes. My head you have anointed with oil. My cup is overflowing. And kindness shall follow me all the days of my life. In the Lord's own house shall I dwell forever and ever.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we also await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. He will change our lowly body to conform with his glorified body, by the power that enables him also to bring all things into subjection to himself. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to the crowds, "I am the living bread come down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." The people quarreled among themselves, saying, "How can this man give us his flesh to eat?" Jesus said to them, "Amen, amen, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you do not have life within you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in him. Just as the living Father sent me, and I have life because of the Father, so also the one who feeds on me will have life because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Unlike your ancestors who ate and still died, whoever eats this bread will live forever." The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. My friends in Christ, some years ago, I can't quite remember how many, Charles told me that he wanted me to preside and preach at his funeral mass. I remember telling him that it would be an honor, a difficult one, but an honor, and I also remember telling him not to be in a hurry. The one thing I didn't do was ask him if there was anything he wanted me to say or didn't want me to say. I wish I had, because it would have made my task this morning easier. I would add that I took it as a measure of Charles' deep faith that he was able to approach the subject of his own death. Not everyone can. In fact, many cannot. But then, as you know, Charles Lonergan was not just everyone. He was one unique fellow, one very unique fellow. A bright, engaging, endlessly interesting, lovable, superbly well-rounded man who left his mark on each one of us, a mark we wear proudly. How lucky we were to have known and loved him, and how blessed we are to be able to gather in this church that for nearly all his life, except for the first 6 years, I think, all his life was his home. The place where he served Mass as a kid and sang in the boys' choir, the place that nurtured his faith and matured his faith. Charles' family home, as you know, where he grew up and lived almost all of his life, is only a couple blocks away. But St. Joe's was every bit as much his home, and it's only fitting that we do his heavenly send-off from this holy place, this home. I mentioned that I wish I'd asked Charles if there was anything he wanted me to say or not to say this morning. Absent that, I'm going to have to depend on the scripture readings for guidance, which is not a bad thing. The reading from Micah, brief and to the point, is a good place to start. You have been told, O mortal, what is good and what the Lord requires of you, only to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. I think that is a succinct but fairly comprehensive commentary on Charlie Lonergan. Doing the work of justice was, of course, what his professional life was all about. Charlie had a love for law, a passion for justice and fairness, and a strong commitment to seeing to it that the law was upheld and his clients well served. He was a bright light in the legal world, a very bright light. He loved his profession, and he was a credit to his profession. It's no accident that he gained the reputation for being one of this area's leading appellant lawyers. I only wish I had gotten to see Charlie in action in the courtroom. I never did. I have to be content with imagining it, which isn't hard. Watching him had to have been a veritable clinic in lawyerly craft, protocol, skill. But there was more to Charlie's life than the legal profession. Any way you look at it, he was a Renaissance man. With his superior intelligence, finely honed wit, gentlemanly manners, exquisite taste, and encyclopedic interest, Charles Lonergan was a Renaissance man and a giant. A gentle giant, for sure, but a giant. Books, as you know, were a big part of his life. He was a passionate collector of books, and his collection is extensive, to say the least. Everything from the great classics to Sherlock Holmes to Winston Churchill, one of his great heroes, whose champagne label Charlie favored, not to mention his hot baths, not, however, his cigars. And then there was Charlie the adventurer. From his boyhood days as an Eagle Scout and his Seattle prep and Seattle University days and all his life long, Charles was in love with the outdoors. Avid hiker, jogger, runner, accomplished mountain climber, Mount Rainier among his conquests, river rafter, even firefighter. There were few challenges in the great outdoors that Charlie didn't take on. And his adventuresome spirit made him a committed traveler too, with many an overseas trip to Europe stamped on his passport. But the passport that meant the most to Charles was his faith. We heard in the reading from St. Paul's letter to the Philippians that our true citizenship is in heaven. And Charles knew that, and he lived by it. There was nothing more important to him than his faith, not even his family and his friends, whom he absolutely adored and loved to be with. Faith, more than anything, defined Charlie Lonergan. He loved the church, loved the Mass, and never missed it, not even when he was traveling and could easily have claimed an exemption, never. He loved the Blessed Mother, too, and he loved the rosary. I hope you picked up one of those rosary back there before Mass started. Appropriately, Charlie died with his rosary in his hands and a scapular around his neck. He loved the Carmelite nuns too, and the Trappists, and he loved the Jesuits. He even had a place in his heart for garden variety priests like me. It was his love and devotion for the Mass that prompted my choice of that passage from St. John's Gospel about the bread of life. "I am the living bread that came down from heaven," Jesus said. "Whoever eats this bread will live forever." Charles knew those words and believed them with every fiber of his being. And if the one who eats this bread will live forever, what better assurance could we possibly have that Charles is now with God? Now, it's not mine to canonize him this morning. The church gets to make saints, not me. Or maybe I should say God makes saints and needs no help from me. And the truth is that there's really nothing I or any one of us could say this morning that would make Charles any better than the good man he was. Not perfect, mind you, just good, really good. I want to close by giving you a picture of the heavenly banquet, which may be just the best image in all the scriptures of what heaven is going to be like. I can't think of anything more appropriate for Charlie, the foodie, the cook with the great fondness for Julia Child, the bon vivant who had exquisite taste when it came to restaurants, but could also enjoy a burger from Burgermaster. I can picture Charles now having taken his place at the heavenly banquet where, according to the book of Isaiah, only the finest foods and the choicest of wines, and no doubt the best of beers, German and maybe even Rainier, are served. Charles has taken his place at that table, met all his favorite saints and family members, and of course, is making many new friends as well. It's a banquet that will never end, and the joys are beyond our imagining. Charlie, dear friend, bask in the unending joy of God's banquet. Be with God now and rest in God's peace, but never stop being there for us.
In baptism, Charles received the light of Christ. Scatter the darkness now and lead him safely over the waters of death. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Charles was nourished at the table of the Savior. Welcome him into the halls of the heavenly banquet. We pray to the Lord. Many friends and members of our families have gone before us and await the kingdom. Grant them an everlasting home with your Son. We pray to the Lord. Many people die by violence, war, and famine each day. Show your mercy to those who suffer so unjustly these sins against your love, and gather them to the eternal kingdom of peace. We pray to the Lord. Charles's family and friends seek comfort and consolation. Heal their pain and dispel the darkness and doubt that come from grief. We pray to the Lord. We are assembled here in faith and confidence to pray for Charles. Strengthen our hope so that we may live in the expectation of your son's coming. We pray to the Lord.
Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ. Grant them a place in your kingdom where you live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept this sacrifice at your hands. We praise the glory of his name, our good and all holy church. As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your faithful servant Charles, we ask your mercy, that he who did not doubt your son to be a loving Savior may find in him a most merciful judge who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him who rose from the dead, our hope of resurrection dawned. The sadness of death gives way to the bright promise of immortality. Lord, for your faithful people, life is changed, not ended. When the body of our earthly dwelling lies in death, we gain an everlasting dwelling place in heaven. And so, with all the choirs of angels in heaven, we proclaim your glory and join in their unending hymn of praise.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts.
Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest, in the highest.
Hosanna.
Hosanna
in the highest, in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the cup, and once more, giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
When we eat this bread, proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. May all of us who share in the body and blood of Christ be brought together into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember your servant Charles, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember all our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Blessed Joseph, her spouse, the Apostle, St. James, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may become co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen, amen, amen.
And now let us pray with confidence to the Father in the words our Savior gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, the glory are yours now. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant us peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer those around us a sign of Christ's peace.
Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, miserere nobis. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, miserere nobis. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, dona nobis pacem.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. Only say the word, my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, your Son, Jesus Christ, gave us the sacrament of his body and blood to guide us on our pilgrim way to your kingdom. May our brother Charles, who shared so frequently in the Eucharist, come now to the banquet of life Christ has prepared for all who love him. We pray through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. And at this time, Dave Nicastro and then nephew Bob Sedarius have some memories of Charlie they'd like to share with us.
Wow, look at all these people. Uncle Charlie, Charles to his friends, would be just delighted that everyone's here for him to have our final send-off, if you will. And I must say I'm honored as a nephew-in-law to be asked to speak today. I have such fond memories of Uncle Charlie. What a great guy, what a great man. We all know how brilliant he was. I was thinking, before Siri, we had Uncle Charlie. He could answer any question and do it in a way that wouldn't make you feel dumb that you didn't know the answer. He'd kind of pull you into the conversation and say, maybe it's this, and you know, I'm not sure, but whatever, he was always right, and just brilliant. So it goes to prove that he not only collected all those books, but he read them, which for me is different, by the way. Anyway, no, Uncle Charlie was quite a unique person and just a delight to always be around. The wonderful trips he put together for the family in going, whether it was to San Francisco or a cruise to Alaska or when he was going to Europe, getting together for just a great dinner at a fantastic restaurant with white tablecloths, which he loved, was always a delight, and he was always so much fun to talk to. But I could also mindful and you know think back. I remember one time we were in a church, and could have been, even been a funeral, and whoever was speaking was just dragging on a little bit, and Uncle Charlie blurted out, "Too long." Sometimes they would also say borax with an X. At any rate, I hope he, you know, doesn't feel that way now. But anyway, Uncle Charlie was, you know, I was quite close. I remember 30 some years ago coming to Seattle with my wife Marion and our kids, and we would go jog the Arboretum, and or we would go on a hike, or we'd just get together and have some fun, and just always a pleasure, and always just the total gentleman whenever we got together, and always made me feel good. So, you know, not long ago when I heard that Uncle Charlie went to Aegis, and of course there was also some other very dear friends who were battling some serious medical issues and cancer and so forth. One, obviously, his partner and my dear friend, Frank Sedarius. When I heard of what they were going through, I wrote a little prayer. And I think Uncle Charlie would like this, but I would say it and thinking of him and all these others. And for those of you that are either facing a medical issue yourselves or maybe know of someone that is, maybe this is something, I don't know, but it's something I wrote. Lord Jesus Christ, you are my guiding light. Give me the strength to win this fight. But if that's not your plan, forgive me for my sins and take me to the promised land. I believe in eternal life. Rest in peace, Uncle Charlie.
Thank you, Dave, for those comments. My name is Bob Siderius. I am Charlie's nephew, and on behalf of my mother, Rosemary, who's here in the second row, and all of our family, I want to thank you all for being here. It's been a difficult weekend, and I can tell you that I think one of the most difficult things was trying to figure out how to tie this bow tie this morning. And it took about a half an hour to do that. And I also, I am here to just, in particular, recognize some people that were important to Charlie in his life, and in particularly in the final days of his life. Gregory and Stuart Vreeburg. I know I see Gregory there and Stuart right behind him. These guys made so many regular trips up here to visit Charlie, especially in his last couple years. Gregory coming from Portland, Stuart coming from Scottsdale, and many Zoom calls, many telephone calls. Stuart making sure that the soft underbelly of Chloe was there for Uncle Charlie to see and comment on. So thank you guys, especially for that last week at the Aegis with you. You guys were just heroes. They were with him 24 hours a day for probably the last 4 or 5 days, which was just great for Uncle and for all of us to know that he had someone there with him. Eric Anderson, my lifetime friend and Charlie's caregiver the last 2 years, thanks for all the comfort and friendship you gave to him. Sister Pat Griswold, a neighbor of Charlie's for all of her life and most of his, who was the go-to person for us whenever we hadn't heard from him for a couple days, and also had to deal with him on several occasions when she found him in not such a great condition in his house, and also for taking him to and from church on Saturday nights, to and from Olympia Pizza all those years. The family really appreciates your doing that. And I want to thank also the folks at the law firm, Michael, Frank, Mary, Valerie, Andrea, for all the support and comfort you gave to him during the years that he continued to come down to the office long after he was practicing law, but just enjoyed being there. And then finally, Father Ryan. First off, I want to tell you that was a wonderful sermon. I think Charlie would have been very, very happy with how that went. And also thank you for all the years of comfort and strength and support. And you were correct that Charlie was not afraid to face death, which is probably why he called on you, what, 6 or 7 times for his last rites? And Charlie was a unique man. He had a lot of things that he loved to do, one of which, actually there's a French word that describes a man like Charlie, and it's called gourmand. And a gourmand, it's an elegant way, of course the French would figure this out, an elegant way to describe someone who likes to eat. And Charlie did like to eat. And if you ever went to his house, you knew that he liked cheese, and he particularly liked stinky cheese. And he would go to the counter at every store and ask the counter person to find him the stinkiest cheese they have. And of course, it would give him some puzzled looks. And then one time, I think Charlie Piazza, my cousin, was with me, and we were asking him, how can you eat this stuff? And he said, well, you need to try it. He said, the bark is worse than the bite. And as Dave says, he was right on that, as he was with most things that actually tasted pretty good for being a terrible smelling cheese. And then Uncle also had a real affinity for what he called the gut buster. And if you ever went to one of his birthday parties, you know what a gut buster is. And he would say that with a gritted teeth and a look of determination like he was going into battle. And I'm pretty sure he won most of the battles that he had with those gut busters. Although I think there were at least 3 or 4 of them when I was looking for Father Ryan for last rites after having one of Charlie's gut busters. And Charlie also liked to have a beer every now and again, a good German beer, and he also really appreciated a little shot of port on festive occasions, which according to Uncle Charlie was any time someone came to visit. Expect to get yourself a shot of port wine. But he was, as you say, a unique man. His favorite thing was to have some action. Wanted to have action. And what he meant by that, I think, is that he just wanted to live life. He enjoyed it with all the sights and smells and personalities and colors and flavors. And he just wanted to get out and experience it. And he did. And he lived a life where he got to experience so many things. He climbed Mount Olympus. He swam the Bosporus. We drank beer with him at Oktoberfest. Chuck was with me when he almost got arrested and beat up the same day searching for the chapel in the back streets of Paris where the Jesuit order was founded. It was quite a day. But we will all miss Charlie. He lived a long life. We should not be sad for him. We can be sad for ourselves, but we know that he is in a better place and happy now. So again, thank you all for coming. On behalf of the family, we appreciate all of you being here to share the celebration of Charlie's life.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Dave. Great tributes to a great man. We'll keep telling the stories for a long, long time, and the action will go on. Please stand. Trusting in God, we have prayed together for Charlie. Now we come to the last farewell. There is deep sadness in parting, but we take comfort in the sure hope that one day we shall see Charlie again and enjoy the wonderful gift of his presence, his love, his friendship. Although we will leave this place today in sorrow, the mercy of God will gather us together again in the joys of God's kingdom. Therefore, let us console one another in the faith of Jesus Christ.
Lord of all hopefulness, Lord of all joy, whose heart is content, whose present hopes born, be there at our waking and give us, we pray, your peace in our hearts, Lord, at of the day. Lord of all eagerness, Lord of all faith, whose strong hands were skilled at the plane and the lathe, be there at our labors and give us, we pray, your strength in our hearts, Lord, at the noon of the day. Lord of all kindness, Lord of all grace, your hand swift to welcome, your arms to embrace, be there at our homing, and give us, we pray, your love in our hearts, Lord, at the eve of the day. Lord of all gentleness, Lord of all calm, whose voice is contentment, whose presence is balm, be there at our sleeping and give us, we pray, your peace in our hearts, Lord, at the end of the day.
Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our dear brother Charlie in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him. We give you thanks for the many blessings which you bestowed upon him in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness, Lord, and of our communion with all the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us now and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your faithful servant and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until that great day when we will all meet together in Christ and be one with you, Lord, and with our brother Charles forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. In peace, let us take our brother to his place of rest. Charlie, may the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. May choirs of angels welcome you and lead you to the bosom of Abraham. And where Lazarus is poor no longer, may you find eternal rest. Eternal rest grant to him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine. May he rest in peace. May his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.